normal birth, you know, lovely Teddy arrives, but there are bruises when Teddy arrives.
Yes, when he was born, he was covered. His face, his arms, elbows.
And what was said at the time?
Yeah.
My mum mentioned it and they said there was no problem, like, it's normal, they can be covered or whatever, but... So they just let me go home the next day.
And these bruises heal on the 20th of August. You notice that some other bruises have appeared on his cheek, but you sort of think, well, maybe he's slept on his dummy, or maybe his sister's got a little sister who maybe have been a little bit rough with him. You could explain it away like that. The 22nd, you take him for a routine health check, and the health visitor asked you where those bruises came from.
Yes, I gave a brief explanation and then she walked out the room, said I've got to do some phone calls, and she came back saying I've had to call social services and the police and I've got to take him to the doctors.
So what did you think at that point? Did you just think...
I was shocked, thinking I don't know what's going on, I don't know what they're thinking, but I took him to the doctors and they checked, they did a whole body map on him and said there was nothing else, just the two little bruises on the cheeks, and they told me to go home, so I waited, went home, and they said, you'll have a police officer and a social worker come round to see you. Mm-hmm. And next minute, there was about 5 to 7 people that walked through my door.
And, police officers?
And social worker.
Wow.
And I got arrested there and then.
And so then he was taken to hospital?
He was taken to hospital. I wasn't there.
Yeah.
I had to
and
go.
That's when you went to the hospital.
Yeah.
And what happened to you when you got to the hospital?
They'd done a paediatrician report, mapped out where all the bruises were on a piece of paper. They found a couple more on his legs and arms, and then they asked me to go to the next room to speak to a police officer, and they arrested me on suspicion of ABH on my son.
And so once you've both been arrested, what happened next? What was the process?
Well, we both was on bail, so we wasn't allowed any contact with my daughter or son or anyone under 16. Teddy was still in hospital at this time, and my daughter, well, which I thought was at my sister's, was actually rushed to foster care.
And so were you saying to the police at the time whilst you were in custody that there's some huge mistake happened here and nobody believed you?
No.
Could hear you?
No. Anything I said, they just said, we've got to do this, this is our job.
It must feel, when you were hours in police custody, and so it's like that moment between being asleep and being awake, you know, that brief moment where there's confusion. I don't know what's happening here. How did you feel?
I didn't know what to feel. I just was crying the whole time in the cell. Didn't know what to do, didn't know who to speak to. When I come out, I just went home and just remember being at home for about 2 weeks on my own.
Well, it was your mum that had this light bulb moment.
Yeah.
And she put two and two together, and it was a condition that you yourself have.
I got diagnosed the same time as Teddy.
Right,
but my brother, Oliver, has it already.
And let's just explain what this is. This is Ehlers-Danlos syndrome.
Yes.
And this is a bruising that can happen throughout the body.
Yep. He's got the type 3, so it's hypermobility. So he's got stretchy skin, fragile skin, bruises easily.
Double jointed bones.
Yeah, all the same. But it's a condition that you can only... You wouldn't know you've got it unless you've been tested or seen about it. So it's quite hard to see from visual.
To prove.
So how did you go about proving that's what it was and getting the diagnosis?
It wasn't until we got to court. So we had to go through court, and I mentioned it to my solicitor and showed her the pictures of Teddy when he was born, because they said it didn't look right. And then as soon as we went back to court, they asked the judge if they could have anything done or anything looked into, and he was taken up to London to see a professional, and he was then looked at then, had blood tests done, and then we just had to wait
So how long between it being discussed, this is the syndrome, this is the cause of the bruising, and you getting him back?
So we had the testing done in October, and he wasn't home until January.
Oh, my goodness me.
So we had to wait that long for the professionals to give their report in.
And then when you finally got him back and you've got your baby with you once again, what was that moment like?
Relief.
Yeah, it was strange, but I was happy to have my family back. It was
and
nice.
It must be very frustrating, because at that age, he's so tiny, you've missed out on a really important part of his life, actually.
The best bit that you want to bond with them, and I missed out on it. It was hard. It was very hard.
Trying to get him back into our own routine with his own parents, because he's been with Gina's sister for five months. She had her own routine. She had her own two kids.
And
coming in back into our life, we've got school runs to do. We've got to get up work. It was hard getting back in a routine.
Yeah, I bet it was.
So we had to judge with my daughter as well, because she was, like, why am I at home and why is he not? So I'd explain to her every day, and that was hard as well.
The judge apologised to you?
Yes.
Yes.
What was the response from social services?
Just, you've got your diagnosis, go home and take your baby home. That was pretty much it.
You can understand that social services, I mean, you know, without that, they do a great job, you know, and you can understand why, if there's alarm bells, that they have to act on that.
I think 100% they should do their job, and I don't blame them for doing that. I just think there's a way to go about it. Like, what they're causing us grief as well, and not just them, so it's nice to...
Joanna's worked in social care for 20 years, and you say that the figures, if you look at them, are staggering.
I know, that's the trouble. That's what we're looking at here. And we were chatting about this earlier. The reality is that time in your whole life that you're most likely to be killed is when you're aged under one. Around half of all the child deaths that happen where cruelty is involved, the child is under one. And bruising in non-mobile babies should always be seen in the light of being abuse, and that's the reality that we're dealing with. And nothing can take away what's happened to this couple, but that's the reality. That's what we see again and again and again.